Well, good morning, Rising Hope. Pastor Michael with you. And it is so good to sort of be back, okay? Here's the deal with Rising Hope Live, your experience. We're doing this in three ways. One, you're either listening at home or in a watch party. So if you joined a watch party this past week, kind of listen together as a small group, that's cool. Or you're almost here. I got to tell you, I start the service with a sense of just a little bit disappointment because this was supposed to be our drive-in service, our very first service. And of course, as you know, the weather did not cooperate, and we thought it would not be a good idea to electrocute anybody holding a microphone. So worship team, we love you. We do. We really do. That wouldn't be good. So what we are doing this week is, hey, we are live for the very first time back in the building. We're so excited by this. Next week is our drive-in service. We're going to try that again, weather cooperating. But I am so excited for today's worship service. But before I turn it over to the worship team to get rocking this house out, here's the deal. Prayer requests. We love it when we get them. It's one of my favorite parts of the service. So this number, it should show up on your screen. Will it show up on the screen?
There it is.
765-200-6165. 765-200-6165. And please text in your prayers throughout the service. Maybe during the worship time, there might be a song or a lyric or a word that just strikes your heart and you think, ah, I need to send in that prayer of praise. Or maybe it's been a tough week and you're going through some things, or you got a word from the doctor that wasn't good and you think, man, I need to have my church family praying. Well, we take your prayer seriously, so don't forget to write that number down. And if God just leads you to text in your prayer to that number, please do that. Please do that, because we love it when we can pray together, because there is power in prayer. And speaking of power right now, I want to turn it over to the worship team. So if you're at home, go ahead and stand up. You're in the house here. Let's stand up. Let's get ready to worship. And let's let our neighbors know the reason of what we can proclaim. The truth in Jesus Christ is good. All right, worship team, let's do it.
Thank you.
that another time when we're together. But right now I'm going to do a song that has really meant a lot to people. As we've been going through this quarantine time, it's one that I've seen numerous people just post things online and, hey, this is my favorite right now, or this song means so much to me. But I've got a verse that I want to read to you before that. It's Philippians 4:4-7. It says, "Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus."
You are here, moving in.
You are the light when things seem so very, very dark sometimes. And God, I pray that as we come to you this morning, and it doesn't look like we had anticipated it looking, Lord, we thought we'd be outside, and, you know, then we thought technology would work. God, you are above all of that. Lord, you can work in amazing, amazing ways, with or without technology. So God, I pray that you work in our hearts this morning, Lord. Will you work in an amazing way? God, will you show us that you are the Lord over everything in our lives? God, will you make us more like you this morning as we listen? In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
All right, so we have some plans. Whether or not those plans will come to fruition, who knows? God knows. We do not. So our plans are that next week we are going to be outside. We're going to be in that little section right by the community center there. You can bring your lawn chairs. We're going to pray that it does not rain. And we're going to hope that as we are able to worship together, it will be a great way to get us kind of back on track and back in our church building. So that's our plan. Our plan is we are together next week. And if you're a little nervous still and you just want to stay in your car, that's okay. We've actually got an app for that. More technology. It's called Listen Everywhere. And hopefully it's going to be a way that not only outside you're going to be able to hear us just fine, but that's something we're going to use once we get back in the building as well for those of you that have asked for assisted listening technology. It's going to be something that's great for that. So we've got plans. We have our plans work this morning. The other thing I want to let you know is we have got a way for you to give online as usual. If you want to text that dollar amount to 84321, we got a thing right there on the screen. So you can just go ahead and text that in, and we'll be able to get that and continue the ministries of the church.
Apparently we need to get stuff to make sure we're, you know, online, so that would be really helpful.
So we've got something special for you this morning. As you know, it is in our vision to plant more churches. We want to plant churches. We want people to hear who Jesus is. And one of the best ways to do that is by starting a church. It's not one of our missions at Rising Hope. And to that end, we invited Trevor and Allie Odell here at the beginning of the year. And for 3 months, everything worked really great. And then COVID hit, and we haven't been able to do much at the church building with them. But you are going to hear from Pastor Trevor preaching for the first time this morning. We are really excited about that. And he's going to be talking about the fruit of the Spirit, gentleness. We're still in our Fruit of the Spirit board game series. So he's going to talk to you about gentleness, and just to get our brains in that gear, we've got a cute little video clip that you're going to see, so go ahead and tune in to that.
Thank you.
the exposure he got and the sensitivity that was so appealing. He talked about the village he was from and his parents, they just wanted to go back there. And he talked about this farm in North Carolina. Mm-hmm. He said he loves it because nobody looks twice at him.
And then we talked about peace, and then used Rock'em Sock'em Robots as kind of an antonym of peace and fighting and quarreling and stuff. And then pie phase was just all about patience and how you're waiting for that pie to hit you in the face, and that was fun. I know we played Babble Daddle, and we just had a laugh, and we talked about joy. And then we talked about kindness with life stories. That was Ed's sermon. And then we did Chutes and Ladders and talking about the goodness and the morals that game used to be about. Snakes and Ladders was what it was called. And then last week, we talked about Soggy Doggy and how a wet dog, every time you get a dog wet, it shakes its fur faithfully, always does it, no matter what. And that brings us to today. And we are talking about gentleness, which is the eighth of nine fruits of the Spirit. So next week is our last spirit. You don't want to miss that. So let's go open up to Galatians 5, and we're going to read from Galatians 5:13. And if you've got it, you know, if you've been following along, maybe you've got a bookmark, maybe you've got it saved on your phone, wherever you read your Bible, that's fine. Just turn to it, and Galatians 5:13. You, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free, but do not use your freedom to indulge the flesh. Rather, serve one another humbly in love. For the entire law is fulfilled in keeping this one command: love your neighbor as yourself. If you bite and devour each other, watch out, or you will be destroyed by each other. So I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the flesh. They are in conflict with each other, so that you are not to do whatever you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. And the acts of the flesh are obvious: sexual immorality, impurity, debauchery, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions, and envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things, there is no law. We've read that passage a few times, and Maybe a few of you have some different versions of the Bible that you're reading there. That's okay. There's no one blank version of the Bible. There are different ones, and translating the Bible in English is really hard. And sometimes it just doesn't quite hit the nail on the head, so to speak. And when you're reading different versions, you might notice that instead of gentleness, it says meekness. I saw that. That's a little odd. A little odd that they use meekness, because meekness and gentleness aren't really the same thing. They don't sound like the same word. You know, when I think of gentleness, the first thing that comes to mind is how I tell Joey to pet her dog. You know, he's a little baby. He can get a little rough sometimes, pulls hair and all that. And gentle, Joey, gentle. Well, and then meekness. Meekness just kind of makes me think of weak. That's like the first thing that comes to mind. Meekness is weakness. In fact, really, Webster even defines meekness, meek as, let me read this in here for the Webster's Dictionary. In fact, it's enduring injury with patience and without resentment, deficient in spirit and courage, submissive, not violent or strong. And I read that and I thought, that doesn't sound like the same fruit Jesus had, deficient in spirit, not strong. I think Jesus had different fruit. Because Jesus was strong. He was like actually strong. You know, he was a carpenter. That was what he did. And he swung hammers and nails and axes at wood. And you have to be strong to do that kind of thing all the time. And Webster's also defines gentle as free from harshness, sternness, or violence. And I can think of a few times when Jesus was a little harsh and stern and even a little violent. You know, like in Matthew 21, when he goes into the temple court and sees that it's been turned marketplace, and he goes up to the money changers and flips their tables over. That's an instance where I think Jesus was just a little bit violent. And then, you know, he was even harsh. He said to one of the disciples, "Go and let the dead bury their own dead. Follow me." Wow. You know, that gets deep. And Jesus did not really shy away from delivering those harsh realities. When you think of gentleness as it's written here in the Bible, like I said, it doesn't just quite get it. And Paul used the word prates. And the Greek for prates is better defined as this, okay? This is what gentleness you can think of, okay? Displaying the right blend of force and reserve. Avoids unnecessary harshness, yet without compromising or being too slow to use necessary force. And it is never something that is humanly accomplished, right? It is the fruit of the Spirit. Fruit of the Spirit. And that makes sense, not humanly accomplished. Now, that's a little lengthy. Maybe that's why they didn't go with that translation of the Greek word prates. So when you think meek and gentle, prates, this is what you should think of. Strength under control. I need to hear that out loud from all of you. I know that's a little hokey when you're online and you're with other people and you're like, I don't want to say it out loud. I don't want them to hear me say that. I got it. I want you to remember that. So say it with me. Strength under control. Okay, one more time. I've got some people in here. Help me out. Strength under control. That's a lot better. Okay. So, Well, that brings us to today's game. And you might have seen it up here, but I need Luke, and I need Mael. And I know, she's right there. Perfect. Now, this is Jenga. I think a lot of us remember that as a kid, but just in case, we have Luke. Luke, tell me how to play Jenga.
You remove the blocks carefully, and then you place it on top, and the first one to knock over the tower loses.
How do you win?
By not knocking over the tower?
By not knocking over the tower. Okay. So there's not like a strategy in how you can win the game, it's just don't knock over the tower or you lose.
Yes.
Okay.
That can be a strategy.
Okay, we'll watch that play out here. Show us how to play Jenga. Oh, wait a minute, hang on a second. Is that hard to see? I guess really hard to see on camera. It's kind of small. Let's okay. Yeah.
I think that might be a little easier to see.
That's right there. Now, I know this isn't a board game per se, but that's good. It's bored. It's made of boards. It's a board game. Okay, so yeah, show us how to play, guys. Well, here, I can demonstrate enough for it. There you go. Try that. Oh, can't push that one out. Okay. And she got one. Went for the easy move first. Took one right out of the middle. Okay. Now, as I'm watching this, I think the strategy here is slower is a little bit better. They're very carefully and concisely finding that one brick that's going to move just right. And not that one. She's going to find one. Try the front side. Well, did you notice here what happened? And I know I kind of used a little bit of brute force there to try to get that brick out, but what happened? The whole thing just toppled over. And, I know this is a little bit of a touchy subject right now, but I really don't think I could have gotten away without talking about it at least a little bit. Just thinking about the state of the world that we're in right now, not just the pandemic, but also the police brutality and the protests that are happening right now. And man, I can't help but feel hurting for police officers and those that are experiencing that police brutality directly. I was a little curious about what somebody thought about strength under control. I asked an officer of mine, a friend of mine that's an officer, I asked him, how do you use strength under control on the job? And I lost my spot. Okay, here we go. Sorry. So this is what he said. Okay, I asked him, how do you use strength under control on the job? That's what he said. Police officers generally have to display strength under control all the time. Basically for everything. And in many situations where I have to run after or chase my own people, once I finally catch up to them and they'll punch me and they'll bite me and they'll kick me, and officers can really only fight back with the amount of force that's needed to get them under control and cuffed. And another example is handling a perpetrator who have committed crimes against children. And we have to handle those perpetrators in the same way that we handle any other perpetrator. Police officers, you know, have a very difficult job, and they have to walk that balance between force and control. It's difficult to do that, especially under tense conditions. And really, unfortunately, not all cops are great at walking that balance. And I'm thankful for my friend here who knows how to walk that balance. So it's important to know that Jesus is our ultimate example and what it means to live by the Spirit, right? Jesus was gentle. And he says in Matthew 11:29, he calls himself gentle. He says, take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. Jesus is gentle. Jesus always demonstrated the perfect balance between force and restraint. And if we take a closer look at Jesus flipping the tables in the temple courts again, this is where we see him kind of displaying some really strong emotions. But he was demonstrating for us strength under control. And he experienced a holy and righteous anger, and he drove out the things that were not of God within the place that we call the house of prayer. And it was this power, this strength under control, aimed at a very specific unrighteous act. He used just the right amount of force for what was needed. And contrary to this, we see him demonstrating strength when force would have been so easy. When I think of Jesus going to the cross, when Judas betrays Jesus and he was arrested, Jesus did not resist. In fact, Peter came up behind him and he swung his sword and he chopped the ear off of one of the soldiers that was taking him. But Jesus has to push him back, and he says here in John 18:11, he says, "Shall I not drink the cup the Father has given me?" See, Jesus knew the will of the Father. It was Jesus' will, it was God's will to go up on the cross and sacrifice his life for our sake, because he loves us. Jesus was very good at showing strength and control. So what happens when we aren't gentle? When we don't pick just the right word, when we don't use just the right amount of force or restraint that is required to remove it, what happens? Well, we saw it here. The tower fell right over. And when you look at this tower, I'm going to tell you what you can see in this tower. You can think of your coworkers and your family and your friends and your neighbors and your spouse and your children. When you look at this tower is there with your relationship with them. And what happens when you don't use just the right amount of force or restraint when you're interacting with them? You're slowly climbing that tower over. And that tower collapses and you push them away. And this is what happens when you can't control your emotions or you overreact. The people you interact with slowly start to not want to be around you. And then what's worse yet is that this can actually cause more quarreling between you and that person. Because when you shout back, you're going to get shout back right at. Like, anger mirrors anger. And you know, think of a time when you've had an argument with your spouse, really anybody, and you just raised your voice just a little bit too high. And then what happens? They yell right back. Almost always. And that's probably how, like, all of my arguments with my wife start. And it's usually my fault. It's usually me that's the one that shouts. She's like, yeah. Yeah, well, I want to get a little vulnerable here, because I do have to say, it does feel like I got kind of I don't want to say the short end of the stick here, but I'll just say this. I don't think I'm there yet. Because gentleness is really hard, and it's really hard for me personally. And you know, I was like, when Mike told me you're preaching on gentleness, I was like, oh great. I'm gonna learn how to be gentle now. So yeah, I'm not always great at showing restraint. For instance, just a couple weeks ago we were leaving for our vacation, and we were gone for about 6 days, and we went up north to our cabin in Michigan. Well, just as we were getting to leave, I had to wait for Allie to get off work. It was about 7:30 or so, and then we had the car all packed up and ready to go. And while I had our tandem bike strapped to the top of our car, right? You've seen those cars and bikes on top of them flying down the highway, right? That's us. We have a tandem that sits on top of our car and we go places. And, well, I forgot it was up there. And you can maybe see where this is heading. I drove under a canopy, and I wrecked the bike and my car, and I was really angry. Handlebars bent all the way back, and you know, bent our roof rack, and it was just, oh, it was frustrating. And then what's worse is that I had to take the bike off, and it was really heavy and hard to get off, and worked so hard to get it up there, and I was ready to go, and now we're a half an hour late, and we're gonna get to where we're going even later, and it was frustrating, to say the least. And, well, I was yelling and grunting as I'm pulling this thing off the car, and we finally get on the road, and it was a quiet 1 hour, you know, first part of the trip there. I upset Allie, she's all tense, and I'm all tense, and Joey's crying. And, oh man, not my proudest moment. And we just got our vacation off to a rough start, just because I was delayed by half an hour. It really wasn't as big of a deal now that I think about it now. It just made the start of our vacation really stressful and tense for no reason. And Jesus was not easily angered like this. He wasn't angered at every little thing, every little tiny inconvenience. Even when the disciples were not really understanding his parables, he would just kind of gently remind them of what he was talking about. And this is because Jesus' number one priority, his number one priority was relationships with other people and God. That was Jesus' number one priority. And Jesus' number one priority being this, we have to make that our number one priority. Because when we make people our number one priority, the result is that we will behave more gently. Anger and toiling just pushes people away, right? And that's just contrary to what God's will is. Because if we are God's way of helping people to find their way towards Jesus, how can we respond in a way that pushes people away? How can we respond in any situation that pushes people away? Our response to all situations needs to be gentle. Jesus responded with strength and control all the way to the cross. And that's because he loves us. And because it was of the Father's will. And the reality is that the opposite to unrestraint, gentleness, that attracts others to us. Because our gentleness, when we are gentle with other people, that communicates love. And our ability to communicate love well to others is the only way to build up the kingdom of God and build up those relationships. Matthew 5:5 says, "Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth." How can we inherit the earth by being gentle? That's crazy. How do we inherit the whole earth by being gentle? Well, it's kind of a cause and effect that's kind of happening here that I see. And it's that when we are gentle, we are becoming the hands and the feet of Jesus. Our meekness and our gentleness causes others to be attracted to us. And they come around us and they get to experience Jesus' love through us. And it opens us up to building relationships with those who do not yet know Jesus, and gives us the opportunity to build the kingdom of God. And it is in this way that we inherit the earth, because we've stored up our treasures in heaven. God wants to bless the meek. Now, gentleness is really hard to be good at. And these are the fruit of the Spirit, after all, right? Not humanly accomplished. We need the Spirit in order to experience these fruit. And I mentioned earlier that I do struggle with not being gentle all the time. And as it turns out, that kind of runs in my family. I didn't really know that until my grandfather told me, just before he passed, he told me something that kind of struck me. He said, I used to be angry a lot. He used to be angry a lot as a kid. And, you know, I was kind of surprised by this because my grandpa is like the most gentle person I know or knew. And he never raised his voice. And I was like, really? You were angry all the time? And he went to camp 1 year when he was 12 or 13. The speaker made a call. And he said, if you're not all in for Jesus, if you're holding on to something that's preventing you from being all in for Jesus, I want you to come to the altar and I want you to write that on a stick. And we're going to burn that stick. And he felt really convicted by that. And he had already been saved at this point. He knew Christ, but he really felt like he was hanging on to that anger and that frustration. And so he went up and he wrote anger on that stick. And then he burned it. And the speaker said that those ashes represent what's behind us now, what God has taken from us. We can't hold on to that anymore. And, you know, some of you might think, oh, you know, I've been to camp so many times, and I've had that transformation experience where I went to camp, and I came back, and I felt so great, and then like a week later, I went right back. And I know that happens a lot, but I can tell you, for a fact, that my grandfather truly experienced the Spirit's transforming power at that camp. Because he came back, and my grandmother told me that his mother said that he saw a transformation in him. He was not the same person when he came back. And I know, because I know my grandfather, and he was not an angry person. My grandfather would testify that God can take that anger from him if you let his Spirit do a work in you. You have to let go of these fits of rage that consume you and give them over to God if you want to be all. And I'm betting that there are probably several of you in here today that are watching online or wherever, and you're not really looking forward to tomorrow when Monday rolls around. And there's probably a situation that you're not really looking forward to entering back into. And I know that we've all had those moments where we've lost control at the wrong time and pushed people away. Well, I have good news for you, because if that's you, I still have to tell you about my favorite part of Django. Okay? Now, these are the actual rules. The rules say that when you lose, you have to come and rebuild the tower for the next game. And so you come over, and you start grabbing your bricks, and you gather them, you put them in rows of three, and you start stacking the tower. And after a while, your tower starts to get built back up. And you can start a new game. And it's a little bit of a process. You know, you have to clean up this messy pile of bricks, and, you know, it just takes a minute. It doesn't happen instantly. And, you know, take your time, though, and eventually you end up with a rebuilt tower when you're done. But the best part about real life that isn't really like Jenga is the fact that we have the Spirit to help us rebuild those relationships. It would be really hard on your own to have to go back and rebuild this tower by yourself, but when you're walking with the Spirit, it comes and it helps you rebuild that tower. And eventually, you have a fully built tower again, and you can start being over. So how do we rebuild our towers? How do we rebuild that relationship that was broken? First, seek forgiveness from God. God, I'm really sorry that I lose control and I get angry. Would you please forgive me? And I promise you, you will. That's how God's grace and forgiveness works. And then the second thing that you have to do to restart the game is you have to start rebuilding that relationship. You have to go to the person that you wronged and say, I am so sorry that I lashed out at you like that. You start from the beginning up, and you say, I'm sorry, will you forgive me? And we rebuild this thing from the start. It's difficult to get out of those pieces again. But after a while, you start rebuilding this, and it gets built back up again. And the thing that's different about Jenga from real life, again, is that not only can you rebuild this tower, but as you play Jenga, as you take the bricks out from the bottom and you place them on the top, the game, the whole tower is just all wibbly-wobbly. And at any moment, it could just fall right over. But that's not what happens in real life, especially when you're walking in step with the Spirit. See, as we're building up and this tower just keeps getting taller, it only gets stronger. As you're working at it and you're working at it, it's not getting weaker, it's getting stronger. I'm really hoping that this doesn't fall over right now, because that would kind of mess me up. But that tower, as you keep rebuilding, gets stronger and stronger as you rebuild it up. And it gets taller, and that will stand the test of time. and those relationships that we're after. We want to pull people closer. And even if people are not gentle towards us, we can be gentle towards them and diffuse that anger, right? So anger only mirrors anger. And when you don't respond in anger, you're not going to get it back. Asking you to seek forgiveness for the people that you've wronged and ask the Spirit to help you control the anger that's inside.
Oh, Rising Hope family, that is a powerful truth about the fruit of the Spirit, gentleness. So much strength can come from gentleness. That's something that I want to pray about, because I don't know about you this morning, but I know for me sometimes that's, gentleness is not the first go-to thing of that I think of, and I think oftentimes I want the other fruits before gentleness. But we know that when we give it all to God, He can build a strong and mighty tower, right? Because God is our refuge and He's our strength in times of trouble. And what a wonderful fruit gentleness truly can be. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, right now, we just seek you in those depths of those spaces where we feel like we might be just ready to topple over. And Lord, we are leaning on maybe our anger, or we're leaning on our bitterness, or we're leaning on just the things that just make us feel, oh, and we just want to thrash out and lash out at those that usually we love the most. Usually that's the case, God. We hurt the ones that we love the most. Now, God, it's in these moments that you are telling us, come to me, especially if you're tired, especially if you need rest. Find the peace and the tranquility and yet the strength of my gentleness. So, God, we give this all to you so that we can find your strength, your gentleness, this fruit in us. Lord, help others to know that this fruit of the Spirit, when we want to lash out first, God, help us to do that check in our spirit and send and share the love of gentleness. So, Lord, as always, each week, as we've been doing, we've been receiving prayer requests online. And Lord, right now I lift up Kelly Thrasher to you and just the prayer requests that Earl and Sue have been giving us. Lord, I also lift up all the residents and care facilities and those friends at Morrison Woods. God, this is a hard time. Many of us, Lord, we can get in our car and we can go, but some of those residents and care facilities just can't. They're kind of still stuck under the quarantine, the restrictions. And Lord, sometimes it's just so hard to be safe. Just like it is, Lord, it's so hard sometimes to practice and receive this fruit of gentleness. And so, Lord, we pray right now with open hands to receive all that it is that we seek you for. And we know that when we do that, Lord, there's just a wonderful blessing. So, Lord, I just continue to pray and seek you, Lord, for just those unspoken requests. Lord, you know our hearts better than we know ourselves, and we just give these prayers to you for you to work. Because, God, just as we sung before, you are the miracle worker. And so, Lord, we give this all to you. In Jesus' name I pray. And everyone said, amen. It's just
so grateful
that you were able to join us today online. Join us on that Zoom call. We'll leave that number up for a couple.